Hi, sisters. Well, today we're going to talk about a psalm, two psalms. I told you we'd come back to these. They really helped me. Have you ever heard this saying, Irma Bombeck, who was, I don't even know if I'm saying her name right, but she was a newspaper article writer and back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and she wrote a lot of humor stuff. And this was the name of one of her books. I've actually read this book. It's great. But it says, if life is a bowl of cherries, what am I doing in the pits? How often have you felt like this? Ever? I think I have quite a bit. And I don't know. I have a personality that I'm an extrovert. I love being around people. But then again, I'm an introvert. I get to where I don't want to be around people at all. It's kind of weird. It's a hot mess. Probably needed a lot of counseling that I did not get. So I'm kind of both. And so it's hard because being that way, sometimes I don't process things like I should spiritually. We're going to talk about that today because I want you to get the help that God's been giving me. I'm not there yet. And I told my sisters yesterday in Sunday school, I said, you're going to have to pray for me. Because I'm learning to crawl out of the darkness and back into the sunshine, just like this poor woman. This is me in the morning. It looks like so many days. I just can't hardly get out of the bed and get with my life, it seems, that it's overwhelming. We'll look at Psalm 42 and 43 today. And I'm going to put the slide on here just so that you can see. This is a Mescal Psalm. It means it's a psalm that was designed to provide insight and wisdom with dealing with certain situations. And in these situations, in this psalm, is really how to handle those blue days, how to handle inner turmoil, despair. Sometimes my sisters at Redeemed and I, we call this spiritual dryness. Just being dry. You know, as pastor's wife, I'm making a point. I want to be real with my sisters. I love my Redeemed Baptist Church sisters. We're family. And we can be real with each other. And I tell them all the time, I'm not perfect. Thank goodness I don't feel like I have to be here. I'm real. This is who it is. And there are times that I will go through spiritual dark spells, spiritual dry spells. And I don't necessarily handle them right. I'm trying. But God's been showing me something. And reading these Psalms are in particularly really good for people going through these spiritually dry spells, the periods of darkness, periods of depression, where you feel like, where's God? Does he not hear me anymore? What's going on? And so we're going to dive into this. I could get into the history behind and all that, but that's not really applicable for what we're going to be doing. So I want you really, with pen in hand, I'm going to show you slides today just because they help my ladies in Sunday school. And I hope that this, the whole point of this is to help people who are not maybe able to go to Sunday school or who are trapped inside or maybe who just needs an extra little, I don't know, something. But anyway, I'm going to go through these and I want to ask you, how do you typically handle turmoil? Let's inventory ourselves. For me personally, I can pout and brood over things that are ridiculous. Tend to want to build a team for my opinion and my focus. Dwell on it to the point where I make everybody crazy. I get tickled because I tell people all the time that God gave me my Hannah for a reason, because I can just vent to her and her personality and mine are very different in ways. And she's like, okay, Mom, it's enough of that. I've heard enough. I'm on your team. I love you, but it's enough. Let's give it to God and move on. Right. And I'm so thankful for that. But how do you typically handle turmoil? Another way that I do it is escape. I love old black and white movies. I'm one of those weirdos, right? And the world that we live in now is so full of chaos. I hate modern stuff for the most part. So I get into my basement. It's a dark hole. And I turn on an old black and white movie or an older movie. Some of my favorites, you know, like Anne of Green Gables. That's not black and white. I love it. Mom, Pa Kettle. Just crazy old movies. And I escape Andy Hardy movies. I just sit there and I eat, obviously, and I escape. But you know what the bad thing is? When you come out from that hole, the problems are still there. The turmoil inside is still there. A lot of times I pull away from people too. I don't want to be around anybody. I tend to just, instead of being hurt or instead of trying to deal with it, I just want to pull away. See, that's not a good way to handle all that. It's actually a very selfish way of handling all that. I want to ask you a question. What effect do you believe your spiritual life had on your perspective at that time? Think on this. If during your greatest, during this time, was your greatest desire, was it, did you want something from God? Or did you long for his presence? Let me repeat that. During a time of this turmoil, whatever it may have been, did you find yourself wanting something from God? Or did you find yourself wanting his presence? Wow. All the time. I can even say most of the time. When I began to study this and I read this particular quote in a book that Charles Swindoll wrote, I happen to think, you know what? Most of the time, all the time, I'm wanting something from God. I want him to fix it. I want him to fix it now. I want him to fix it the way I want him to fix it. And then I get frustrated when he doesn't fix it or he doesn't answer my prayer. That's not how God works. And then I start the whole pulling away and the whole cycle that's not good. And I get myself in a mess to where eventually I have to find a way to crawl out of it. So I didn't handle it well at all. Where's your turning place? You know, when you have this turmoil that hits you, and we'll talk about different types of turmoil. You know, your kids are sick, financial turmoil, somebody's talking about you at work, somebody's persecuting you in some way with their words or with their actions. You're left to hold the bag. I don't know. There's so much turmoil. Adult children who are astray. You may have a sickness, someone you may have that you know and love has a sickness. You may have suffered a heart attack or a stroke like I did, or maybe you've lost a loved one. Whatever your turmoil is, it blindsides you, right? Where's your turning place? Where's that place inside of you that turns? Is it your stomach? Is it your head? No sleep? Crazy cravings, escapism on your phone. You know, this young generation, they are addicted to their phone. They go through a trauma and they got to have that phone. It's like a security blanket. Or do you hurt yourself? Cutting yourself, hurt yourself in some other way. That seems to be very popular with the young adults and people that I talk to. They're just in so much pain. The only way that they can get out of that pain is by hurting themselves. It sort of like releases the pain. You see, that's not how God wants you to handle all that. And that's why these two Psalms are so important to helping us find peace. Because God wants us to find peace. Before we dive into these, I want to show you the six things that God highlights in these Psalms that we can look at. The six causes of, or the six reasons, or the six ways, or things that we do. I don't know how you want to word it for you to help you understand, but these are things that we find in Psalm 42 and 43. James Boyce wrote it in a book that he wrote. It was a really good book on the Psalms, but that we can really look at and compare to today and how we get in the spiritual depression, how we get ourselves in this. One is sometimes we have a forced absence from the house of God, where God is worshiped. You stay out of church because of a sickness or something. And the more you stay out, the easier it is, right? You pull away from God. If you pull away from God, you're pulling away from iron sharpening out, iron influences. And you're pulling away from the place where you're supposed to come. Don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. That's where you come and you encourage one another. You exhort, the Bible says. You exhort one another. You come and encourage and help one another. It could be taunts of unbelievers. Maybe you're trying really hard, but your coworkers or your, your family, or they're continually hounding you or pounding you about your old-fashioned faith. It's funny to me today, the difference from when I was in school, college. You know, when I was in college, we would agree to disagree and move on and still work in groups together and still be friends and acquaintances. But today, if you don't believe in something that somebody else is believing, they get mad. And there's no, let's work it out. We've lost that. And that's sad. But are you taught? Maybe your old-fashioned faith, or you're demonized because you're a Christian. That could be hard. Memories of better days. This is a tricky one. And we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But living in the past, good memories. Getting yourself worked up to where you think it'll never be good again. The overwhelming trials of life. Bills, pressures of life. They just take over you. Failure of seeing God act fast on your account. You know, I've prayed and it seems that nothing seems to happen. Nothing changes. I'm still dealing with this. Our ungodly, deceitful, wicked people. You know, here, why live for Christ? Look, they're not, and they're doing great. I am, and I'm in despair. Can you see how these six things can really get you messed up? I'm going to tell you, it is so true. Many times in my life, if I am walking in spiritual darkness, the first place I don't want to go is church. Preacher's wife don't want to go to church. Yeah, it's true. If I'm walking in a dark spiritual place, something's happened, turmoil, stress, I'm in this escapism mode, I don't want to go to church. Either because I'm going to get convicted, I don't want to be encouraged, I want to brood and mull over what I'm going through. I'm liking it. My flesh is liking it. And you're like in stunned, like, really? Yeah, I'm being very serious. And then when I'm not in church, you see, then I don't get the things that I need. And then I begin, my thoughts begin to spiral down, like we've talked about in other videos. And I begin to go to these things and think about these things. The grass is always greener on the other side, as they say. And it starts to create bitterness and things in my life. And that's not good. Sisters, it's not good. Let's take one, each one of these for the most part, and let's dive into these because I think it'll help you. It sure has helped me. The first one, absence from the house of God. Look at what happens here in the psalmist and what he says. That's the heart, that's the deer. Panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee. Oh God, my soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? Do you hear his desire in that verse, those verses? I got to thinking about an example that maybe would help some of you ladies understand this. My daughter has a brand new little precious little girl, and I love this little sweet bundle of joy. And she's nursing. And I look at this as, when you're nursing a baby and that baby is so hungry, its stomach's hurting, it's in turmoil, it's in inner despair because it's hungry, it's going to let you know really quick that he is, or she is, longing to be with their mother. It's a panteth, it's a strong pull to their mom. You know, as I was watching Rennie the other day, and she was in turmoil, she was ready for her mother. And she was not happy, and she was in distress. And I got to thinking, man, I need to be like that for God. When turmoil hits, when that stomach churning place hits me, instead of going away from God, I need to be yearning for God, like that baby's yearning for its mother, like the deer is panting for the brook. And that's what the psalmist here. Remember, it's a psalm to help us, to instruct us in time of despair. And that's the first thing it's saying. When we hit that despair moment, we need to be hungering after God. So good. And then look what it says in verse 40, 2:3. This is for coworkers, families that are continually pounding. It says, my tears have been my meat day and night. While they continue saying to me, where's your God? He's been struggling day and night. Man, can I say that happens to me day and night? Sometimes my thoughts just will not hush. It continues on and on. And I want to, you know, I can't sleep. And so now, not only have I pulled away from people, I'm brooding on it. Now I can't sleep. And that's going to make you worse as far as depression and things like that goes, because now you're not going to be able to think clearly. It's just a vicious cycle. And Satan's sitting back there and he's laughing, ha, 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 because I ain't got you where you're way far from where you need to be. And I'm getting the victory. And I'm just still brooding, just still allowing him just to eat me alive. This must have been pretty something, pretty significant in this psalm, because it says again in verse 10, look, it kind of goes along with this again. And we'll talk about, we'll repeat this again, but it says, as with the sword of my bones, my enemies reproach me. Why they say daily to me, where is your God? Where is your God? Isn't that true? When you're going through a hard time, and if you don't surround yourself with iron sharpening iron friends, you're going to begin to hear that voice of Satan. Remember the three big lies? You're useless, you're helpless, you're unlovable. Remember? And he's going to be throwing non-Christians, or maybe Christians who aren't where they need to be, or they're not iron sharpening iron Christian friends. And they're going to be saying things to you, where is your God in this? Think about Job and his friends, right? Where is God? And that just gets you in more turmoil. You begin to think, where is God yourself? Get that thought. Maybe you feel forsaken, forgotten. Oh, Satan's jumping on that. People who even mean well will say, you're living in sin because you're sad. Well, that's ridiculous. David was a man after God's own heart. He was sad and it had inner turmoil quite a bit. We see that in his Psalms. Don't allow Satan to do that to you at all. But then we get, I love this, because then we get to verse 5. I want you to look at this. When I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me, for I had gone with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise, with the multitude and kept holy days. I remember I used to be the one that was worshiping and praising God. I was in those great services that we've had. I know what God can do. But where is he now? And this is where you have to be careful. It's tricky, because if you're living in the past where it's making you brood and think that you'll never be there again, and Satan has robbed you of your tears, he's robbed you of your joy, then he has won the victory in that. But if you remember what God has done, and the psalmist here has taken us to this, and you know what he's done in the past, and you claim what he can do in your future, and you live in the victory, like Donna told us last week in her testimony, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. I will walk in victory. And we begin to practice what we're going to learn in the next verse. Then you can see a difference. Because you see, in the very, very next verse, it's coming around. Here we go. Why art thou cast down, O my soul, and why art thou disquieted in me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. Disquieted in me means inner turmoil. Now put your name in it. Let's go back. Put your name in it. I'm going to put my name in it. You put your name in it, because it's so cool that way when you put your name in it. Why art thou cast down, Landa? Oh, Landa, why are you in turmoil? Why are you disquieted in me? Landa, hope in God. He's the help of your countenance. He's the only thing that's going to bring you out. You know what's so cool? This particular verse is repeated 3 times in Psalm 42, 43. And I learned a long time ago in a CalArthur study that anytime something is repeated in the Word of God, you better stop. And you better really study it out. This is 3 times. We better stop. Think about what it's saying. Why are you cast down? Your hope is in God. Your help is in God. So what is he starting to do here? And there is something he's starting to do. And this is, it's just so cool, because all those six steps that we went through, and you get to this verse here, and he begins to help you overcome. What does he tell us to do? What is it? What's going on here? Self-talk. Remember what God has done with the mind of he can do it again. Hope in God. Trust in him and his ways. Put your mind on him. Fellowship with his people. Self-talk. Start talking yourself out of it. Father, help me. I'm in despair. I'm going to remember when you what you've done in the past. Satan's trying to derail me with this right here. I refuse. There's absolutely nothing I can do to prevent it, to take care of it, or to change it. I'm going to have to trust you, because you alone can do what you need to do. I can't do it. I give it to you. And you're going to have to continually say it over and over and over and over again. Self-talk. And as you're self-talking, get with believers. Get with other believers. Listen to what, one of the reasons why we come to church. Last night at church, we had a young man come and speak who, wow, preached. And he shared a little bit of his testimony with them, what God has done. And when we all left, we were all looking at each other like, yeah, I live in victory. We can do this. Coming together. But Satan so many times wants to keep you away from church, because he's thinking, he feeds your mind that there's so many more things more important. I realize sometimes you can't. But if you can and you're able, you should be there. And if you're not going to a Bible-believing church where you can be encouraged, go somewhere else. Because it's that important. Get with self-talk. Get with other believers. I love this. When you're self-talking, rather than allowing circumstances to talk to us, we need to talk to the circumstances. Is the case of the mind speaking to the emotions rather than the emotions dictating to the mind? Take yourself in hand. Address yourself. Exhort yourself. Take your emotion. Talk to your emotions. I've been practicing this. Yesterday, Alan preached at the prison yesterday morning. And those mornings are so hard right here usually, because it's like, okay, I'm going to get you. That's all I'm going to know today. Because I was studying for the Sunday school lesson, and God was really working in my heart. I was just having a high whole time praising the Lord and just going through the morning. And I just started self-talking. Oh, no, I have victory in Christ. Oh, no, stay away from me. And a little something popped up, you know, on my phone. And I'm like, nope. Immediately, I was like, nope, God, I trust you with this. I'm giving this to you. He's trying to derail me first thing this morning. I'm not going there. I'm not. And I kept on just self-talking and doing scripture. You know what? I had a great morning in the Lord. Exhorting yourself. Come on, Landa. You can do this. Don't be cast down. You have victory in Christ. Put your name in it. Now, people may think you've gone crazy. Who cares? I give up, quit thinking what people really think about me a long time ago. I am half crazy, and that's okay. And I am different, and that's okay. And I am peculiar. Well, hallelujah, right? Can't say that I'm peculiar for Christ all the time, but I am rather peculiar. Self-talk. Exhort yourself. God is so good. Another way to help. Look at this. Challenge yourself to do what you'll be doing. Put your hope in God. How? Put reminder verse cards in several places. Start prayer journaling. Take those satanic lies captive like we've talked about in the past. Live victorious. Put Bible verses everywhere. That little quote there in Sunday school yesterday, I made the ladies little cards that said that, you know, talk to your emotions. Don't let your emotions dictate to you. Maybe you need to write that down on a card. You can go back and stop the slide and copy it down and put it somewhere. And then write you a verse underneath that will help you. You know, whatever you're going through, whatever turmoil, all you got to do is go to the internet, the computer, and use it for something great. And type in Bible verses on, I don't know, depression. Bible verses on discouragement. And it'll list you a bunch. Get you a few. Read through them. Get you one or two. Write them down. Put them before your head, your mind. It works. When my kids were little, still living at home, I sometimes would put Bible verses on the mirrors in the bathrooms. And then it got to where I saw Hannah was the best at, she would write little Bible verses and she'd put them on her mirror when she was a senior in high school. She had a really hard senior year. It used to bless my heart to go in there and see her little verses hanging in her room in places. Put it before you. That's another way to get out, right? The next verse, look at this one. Once again. Oh my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore, while I remember thee from the land of Jordan of the Hermonites, from the hill Mizar. You see, he's beginning to remember and to talk to himself and to think about what God has done. Then you get into, the 43, eventually there. Deep call the deep, noise of the waterspouts, the waves or the billows are gone over me. There it goes, when the pressures of life get so hard, bills are unpaid or something happens that you just feel like you're absolutely drowning. But the ocean waves have come over you. Envision yourself standing in the ocean as a kid and the ocean breaks right on top of you, the wave. And then before you can get back up, another one's coming. That's how he's feeling. And you can see this turmoil that he's going back and forth. He's self-talking himself out of it. And then he's going right back in. And that's how we do, isn't it? We get a little bit better and then we fall back down. Get a little bit better, fall back down. And so this is, we're seeing this. I'm going to tell you this right here. Change your environment and escape your routine and pray. Get away from the distractions. Get where you can hear God. For me and for my husband, and we even share it with some of our neighbors, is our pond. We have kind of an unspoken thing that when you see someone down at the pond, don't go down there. Leave them alone. We're talking to Jesus. It's a sanctified place down there. I've heard my husband praying and shouting down there at the pond. There's been many times I've gone and just took a blanket and lay down and just prayed. There's something about being outside. I'm an outside girl anyway. I love the mountains. There's something about it. Something about a creek stream. Maybe it's because I went trout fishing with my dad all the time. I don't know. And I would read books and he'd fish and I'd just sit there and eat my peanut butter sandwich and loved it. But remove yourself from your normal routine and seek out God. I'm about done. Hang on. This one's a little bit longer. But we see that he's looking at the sky. He's, as you're going through the Psalms, and I love verse 9 because he's self-talking again. He says, I will say to God, my rock, why hast thou forgotten me? I feel like you forgot me, God. Why go mourning because of the pressure of my enemies? And he's searching and he's crying out and he's talking. And then he says, this with my sword and my bones, my enemies reproach me. And it's that scripture again. I mean, he's just really in turmoil. And then look at verse 11. There it is again. I love it. Why art thou cast down? Why are they disquieted in me? Why you got inner turmoil? Hang on a minute. Why? Hope in God. He's the help of my countenance. He's going to be your help. He's your God. Thirst for God. Want the presence of God more than wanting God to fix it. And that's where it is right there. Wanting the presence of God more than wanting God to fix it. I encourage you to read Psalm 42, then go on to 43. We've done enough of 42. Now you'll see the pattern in 43 again. And you go get to the end where he said, why are you cast down? Hope in God. God is your help. I love that. Sisters, pray for me that I can remember that. I pray and hope this helps you some. If you're in that depressed state, pray and ask God to help you. Remember to talk to your emotions and tell them what to do. Get you some scripture to write down, to look at and read when Satan puts those lies in your head so you can cast them aside. Tell yourself you're going to live in victory. Get yourself away from your normal routine if it's just for 10 minutes. Sit down on the grass, watch for fire ants. Learn that the hard way. Get somewhere. Talk to God. Just you and him. Leave your phone at home. Just get away. Let him help you find peace. And little by little, You know what's going to happen? I know, because it's happened in my life so many times. You're going to find that spiritual peace again. It's not going to be dry anymore. And God's going to be like, why'd you leave me? Why'd you walk away? Next time, come to me. Come to me. I don't know. I love you. Thanks. Hope you had a great week in the Lord. And I hope to see you next week. And there you go. And if you're watching this, happy 4th of July. Today's 4th of July for me. By the time you see this, it's going to be after 4th of July. But happy great Independence Day of a great country. Love you. God bless.